Tonight's game, live from Three River Stadium in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, the Houston Gamblers play the Pittsburgh Maulers. Let's take a look at the Central Division of the USFL. The Gamblers might be saying, oh my heavens, for Michigan broke a four-game losing streak yesterday to regain the lead in the division. Houston and Oklahoma are game behind at 6-5. Now, take a look at what Houston has done in five of their losses. There have been by 3 points, including three overtime losses, also by 3 points. They could very easily be 10-1 instead of 6-5. And good evening, everyone. I'm Jim Simpson with Smiling Don Heinrich. We are here. That's the Houston Gamblers story. We'll have more about that. But Don Heinrich, how about Pittsburgh? Joe Pendry fired. Ellis Raisberger, new coach. And everybody's saying, what in the world has happened to Mike Rozier? We read nothing about him. He scored one touchdown all year long.
Well, Rozier is not enjoying the success he had behind that big Nebraska line. Here, the Maulers, the key is that offensive line. He's having to fight for every yard that he gets. He's having to earn it the hard way. On the other hand, you could liken it to O.J. Simpson's early years in Buffalo. And the other story is Carano, the quarterback. His statistics, fairly impressive. Not many points on the scoreboard. For them to be competitive tonight, they're both going to have to do well.
The Maulers dressed in black, white numerals, and across the way, the Gamblers 6-5, but all those losses by 3 points. Four of their five by 3 points. Michigan did manhandle them, make no mistake of that. But the Gamblers are in the race in the Central Division as we wind down the final third of this USFL season. Kicking off will be Tony Lee, a rookie out of Toledo where he set all kinds of records. And he is the second kicker they have had this year. The first one is long gone. Tony Lee was brought in very early on. And here come the Gamblers out, and you would expect that Clarence Verdan will be the deep man, number 89. But we'll check that as they head back. He is in the middle. Calvin Eason comes wide to your left. On the far side, turning around, it looks like Vince Corville, number 83, is the other man deep. So it is Eason, Verdan, and Corville who are deep, awaiting the kickoff of Tony Lee. And this ball game has already been delayed, as you can tell by my going on, about 7 minutes past its scheduled kickoff time. Lead a kickoff. And this is Verdan in the end zone, but it's going to go out of the end zone, so it'll come out to the 20-yard line. First and 10 from the 20. And you know, of course, Jim Kelly coming out 24, or rather 246 to 388, better than 67% of his passes he has completed. 23 touchdowns, 18 interceptions. Now, they don't use any tight ends. The only running back is Todd Fowler, 46. They have two slot backs, Ricky Sanders, 80, and the league's leading pass catcher, Richard Johnson, 22. And then two wide receivers, Greg Moser, 85, Gerald McNeil, 13, Ron Dowson, Tommy Robinson, the tackle, Scott Boucher, Billy Kidd starting tonight over the injured Donnie Martin at guard, and Frank Khalil, the center. Johnson, the man in motion. Here they come. Kelly in trouble, gets away, down he goes. Ernest Graham, or rather David Graham, number 97, comes in to make the stop. This first-year man out of Morehouse. Kelly looked downfield, and on that play, at least, Don Heinrich, all of those receivers were covered. Defensively will be Sam Clancy, 77. David Graham, who made the tackle, 97. Troy Thomas, 90. And Don Holly, 99, the front four. Ron Crosby, 54. Ernest Adams, 50. Mike McKibben, 53. The linebackers. And the secondary is decimated. Tonight we'll have Mark Harper, 26 at one corner. Jerry Holmes, a good one. X-Jet, 47 at the other. Mickey Sutton, 32. Jesse Johnson, 29, the safety. Second down from the 15. Kelly in trouble again. Now, Don, this is about the fourth Houston game I've seen. I haven't seen Kelly sacked maybe once in each of those games. Twice in two plays.
Well, last week, he was sacked five times as he's rolling out to that right side a little bit, bearing down on him, 77 to Sam Clancy, and then, of course, they get the cleanup shot, but that's two in a row by keeping him inside, which is what they want to do. They've widened those defensive ends up, and certainly the first two plays, they've been successful.
Third down and 18 from the 12-yard line.
Kelly hasn't gotten a pass off yet. Who would have thought that? I wouldn't have. Here comes Johnson. Kelly again. Look out. Blitzes on. Gets it out to Fowler, who drops the ball. Fourth down. They'll have to kick it away.
Well, had they completed that, it was a screen to that left side. Fowler had plenty of running room, and he should have caught that football. But give credit to Mike McKibben. The linebacker was bearing down, and it forced the ball to be thrown a little bit quick by Kelly before Fowler could get turned. So right now, that pass rush is effective.
Dale Walters to kick the ball away. Mark Harper waiting at about midfield. Rushes on high. Harper did not call for a fair catch. I can't believe that either. At the 47-yard line. So let us bring out the offense now. Glenn Carano take it out in the fourth quarter. Said he had a sore elbow last week. We'll try it again tonight with Tom Rosanski in the wings. Mike Rozier, he does almost everything, number 30. Walter Holman, 32, the running backs. Greg Anderson, 80. Jackie Flowers, 84, the wide receivers. Each has caught six touchdown passes. We'll check on that tight end for you. It's supposed to be Mark Rao, 83. Mags and Hickman, the tackles. Corbin and Lukens, the guards. And Correll at
72.
Center. Rozier flagged down, and Rozier down. Rozier got absolutely nowhere. Cleveland Crosby came in to make the stop. But the first flag of the night. Offside, charged against Houston, so the Gamblers have done next to nothing right so far. Instead of a loss of about a yard, it'll be first and five, and they'll march the ball in the Gambler territory.
And Jim, this is an area that the Maulers, who have had trouble putting points on the board, getting the football in excellent field position, have to take advantage of.
Houston defensively, Cleveland Crosby, 78, Tony Fitzpatrick, 62, Jose Taylor, 93, Pete Caton, 77, the front four, Mike Hawkins, 57, Kiki Diallo, 31, Eric Scoggins, 55. The linebackers, I'll give you the defensive backs in a moment. First and five, Rozier again. Rozier almost broke it. Almost broke it. Gets to about the 40-yard line before Pete Caton field back to make the stop. Your defensive backs, Mike Mitchell, 35, Will Lewis, 24, Calvin Eason, 34, and Hollis Hall, 25.
I tell you, if Mike Rozier had not been tripped up there, he would have had that longest run of the season for him this year because he had nothing but daylight. Got a nice crack on that pitch.
No score. Pittsburgh with the ball at the Houston 40. 12 and a half minutes left in this, the first quarter. Well, Rozier's got it again and picks up about 5 yards down near the 35-yard line. Hanging on was Taylor.
Well, Mike Rozier getting a straight handoff up there. A little bit of an overshift by the defensive line. That's why he veered slightly back to the left center of the screen to hit that little bit of daylight.
Second down and about six. Now it is the fullback, number 31. Never carried the ball in his career, but he used to be a tackle. There's Rozier running the ball again, and it's going to be third down on short yardage. About a yard or two to go, and that is all. And you can see that Calvin Eason and Eric Scoggins, 55, made the stop.
The kick out by Dan Dubiago, number 72, the right tackle, is what opens it up initially. Big Ira Albright, former defensive lineman, 260 pounds, as he helped Dubiago. They moved him to fullback because they were short of running backs and they wanted to get more strength up in front of Rozier. He did it there.
Too small for a defensive lineman, awesome as an offensive back. Here's Rozier again. He's going to lost the football. It's picked up by Eason. Eason is across the 40-yard line, and Carano will make sure he gets out of bounds. Rozier carried every single play, finally fumbled the ball. Calvin Eason picked it up and ran it back to midfield. And the Gamblers.
out of the eye off the left side. Once again, in front of him, big Ira Albright. Nice crack in there. Didn't have the ball put away. Didn't have his hand wrapped around the front of the football and popped it out as he went through that crack. And then on the spot, Ethan picking it up. As he comes through, you can see him get a little shot there, but did not have the football put away.
I think Ira Albright is the man that knocked it out. His own man with him with the shoulder. No score, 10:58 to go. Houston has the ball. Pittsburgh stopped Houston, forced them to punt, got the ball, moved into Houston territory. Rozier fumbled when he ran into Ira Albright, and Eason picked it up and raced it back to the 50. And here comes Jim Kelly, sending McNeil wide to the left, Mosier to the right. His slot backs remain Richard Johnson and Ricky Sanders. That is Sanders. Kelly gets his first pass away. Mosier does not catch the ball. Good defensive play there by Mark Harper, the rookie out of Alcorn State, who plays the corner. Second and 10.
Mosier on a post pattern. He just takes it straight downfield and breaks it to the inside. He actually gets a step or so. When he gets that close, you see him turn Harper around 26, the ball a little bit short, giving Harper a chance to recover. Right at the end, as Harper comes back with Mosier trying to adjust to the football, gets saved from a big gain.
Troy Hill is in there. They're using five defensive backs. Second down, 10. That is Richard Johnson in motion. Kelly gets the ball and overshoots everybody. Anderson and McNeil. Both were downfield. Anderson on the inside, McNeil on the sidelines. And it is third down and 10, and Kelly has not completed the pass tonight. I'll give you that Todd Feller dropped one, but the stats will show that Jim has not completed one tonight.
Well, he had Ricky Sanders wide open in the middle on the turn in, and of course, he's from this area playing at East Brady PA High School just outside of Pittsburgh, and he's got a lot of family here, so maybe he's just a little bit apprehensive because he's certainly gotten off to a slow start and is not the Jim Kelly we've seen previously.
And now Verdana is in and goes wide to the left, number 89. Kelly looking for Mosier. There he goes. Mosier, first down inside the 15. Harper made the stop. And Kelly hits on his first one from midfield to the 11-yard line.
Well, you know, it's a matter of time as he sprints out semi-roll to the right side. Troy Hill, number 25, the defensive back, is the one that gets beat. Came back with the same post pass that was a little bit short, this time successful.
I tell you, Harper made the tackle, and Harper showed me some speed catching up to Mosier. First down at the 11 after a 39-yard pickup. No score, 10 minutes to go, first half. Verdan remains in, goes wide left. McGee is in, has come to the right. There's Fowler on his first running play, and he gets down to about the 8-yard line before the stop is made there by Don Holly, 99, and Mike McKibben, the leading tackler, number 53, the outside linebacker on the right side. This defense of Pittsburgh has played tough football all year long, and they'll need to play tough football tonight. That Jerry Holmes in your picture, 47, was the fellow who had the great career with the Jets. They've been throwing away from him all year. Second down, Kelly looking, going out there, and Johnson can't hold on to the ball at the 3-yard line. Richard Johnson made a jump for it. The ball was there, and he couldn't hold on to it. He is the league leader with 77 catches.
Well, once again, he was wide open. The coverage was man for man, and you will see Johnson, 22, come wide open. A perfect throw. Should have caught it despite being a little bit high, but nobody else in the picture. And that's one of the problems that the Maulers are going to have. Ellis Rainsberger, the head coach, said that he wanted to keep changing the defenses up, but was going to play essentially man for man in order to stay with the quickness of this Houston team. Right there, they made a mistake.
Ball is at the 8-yard line, third down and 7 to go. Kelly goes out here for Fowler. He was hit as the ball got there. Good defensive play. by David Graham. Fowler says he hit me before the ball got there. But here comes Tony Fritz.
Well, David Graham was locked in. It was going to be that little short screen, quick screen to the right side. Had not David Graham did that or make that play, Fowler would have walked into the end zone.
Tony Fritz on the year, 5 of 7. But then again, Tony Fritz had not kicked it low last week to allow Corker to block it, Houston would have beaten Michigan. As Fritz said, I've got no excuses. This will be a 25-yard field goal attempt. He is 3 for 3 inside the 30. Moore's the man holding. He'll try to get it up this time. Does get it up. And from 25 yards out, has the first score of the night. 9-10 to go. Tony Fritz puts Houston in front of Pittsburgh by a field goal. Welcome back to Three Rivers Stadium in Pittsburgh. The score is 3-0. Fritz, who just kicked the 25-yard field goal, will, of course, kick it off. William Miller is the deep man. There is Tony Fritz. And there is Miller walking over to talk to one of the up men, who is Johnny Durden. Miller played in the CFL and came down here because an assistant coach has been up there with him in the CFL.
But, Jim, you know, we expressed earlier that the Maulers are going to have to do everything right tonight. When they had excellent field position after the first punt from Houston, unfortunately, they had a turnover, their 9th fumble of the season, and they can't do that if they want to stay close to this Houston team.
Jim Kelly's completed only one pass tonight, but that was for 39 yards. Here's Fritz with a low kick up, and that is Johnny Durden trying to find the handle, now trying to find some running room, and he's crushed at about the 24-yard line. And that is all. Durden goes down. Durden played with the Oilers and the Chiefs and then the CFL. 6 plays, 42 yards they went. And I'll dispute that because he's knocked out of bounds at the 50-yard line. 1:48 was the time off the clock on a 25-yard field goal. However, it is 3-0 on a beautiful night in Pittsburgh and a good crowd. Now the Maulers 2-9. Remember the first time they had the ball, Rozier carried it every single time. Carano never threw the ball once. And Rozier's got it again. This time not as much. Not as much. Jose Taylor and Kiki Diallo came in to make the stop. Diallo, the middle linebacker, makes the tackle. Not a big man, but very quick and the leading tackler.
Kiki Diallo, number 31, steps up to the block there of Chuck Corral and then plays off, but uses good leverage to step in and make the tackle.
Ball at the 27-yard line, second down, 8 to go. They've got dangerous receivers in Jackie Flowers and Greg Anderson, but they haven't thrown yet. There's the fake, and Corano won't get the ball off. Lost the football, they say.
Looked like he was down before the ball came loose, but it'll depend on the official as to what the decision is going to be.
Tony Fitzpatrick comes up to it because there's also that business of being in the grass, which was not called.
Well, he goes with the play action, and that's something they like to do. It was just off of the previous type of a play. Pressure coming inside, you see Carano try to sidestep.
He fumbled.
And then it gets just a little bit late as Hosea Taylor gets to a first. Fitzpatrick, 62, the little guy, happens to be on the ground, keeps coming, great quickness. Jack Pardee says that he can't stand up and make a lot of moves on folks. He just drives into him and uses his quickness and strength.
First down from the 15-yard line. Kelly, first touchdown! 78th catch of the year for Richard Johnson and his 9th touchdown catch. And Pittsburgh, with 5 turnovers in the first half last week against the Express, are trying to self-destruct again tonight. Kelly's 2 completions, 39 yards, and this for 15 and a score.
That was Johnson coming across the backfield, number 22, as Kelly rolling right. Just runs a post corner move, and there is absolutely nobody there. And Jesse Johnson, number 29, is the man that's saying, wait a minute, who's supposed to cover him? Is he your man or mine? I'm a little confused.
Everybody in the USFL is confused, trying to cover all those folks coming out of the Houston backfield and off the line of scrimmage. 26 to add the extra point, if he can. And he does, and just like that, the direct result of two fumbles, Pittsburgh finds itself behind. Houston finds itself ahead. 10-0 the score.
We move ahead to the start of the second quarter. Houston still leads 10-0 over Pittsburgh. The Gamblers have the ball on the Maulers 46, second down and four.
We begin the second quarter, Three Rivers Stadium, Pittsburgh. I'm Jim Simpson with Don Heinrich. And Jim Kelly's in some pain over there. He's pointing at the inside of his right elbow. And they're putting some kind of bandage on there. But then again, the Maulers have to be concerned about Todd Dillon. He's moving the ball very well.
You can see that Kelly took that elbow pad off. It felt a little uncomfortable, but you look at the stats. Time of possession, essentially the same, but look at the passing yards for Pittsburgh are absolutely zero.
The best drive of the night has been by the Maulers on the opening drive. Other than that, there's been no drive. Then turnovers. There's Todd Dillon. Gets the ball out and holding on to it is Sanders with his first catch of the night. Mickey Sutton, number 33, ran him out of bounds across the way, along with Troy Hill. But that's the first down at the 40-yard line. That's the thing about Mousy Davis and his Mouseketeers. You get a man who can throw the ball in there, he's got so many people to throw to, he's going to have a good night.
Well, Dillon had good success at Long Beach State out in California. It really doesn't seem to matter who's in the lineup. Obviously, they'd like to have Kelly, but Dillon's getting his opportunity here, and that's got to be a really fun offense for a quarterback.
He'd only thrown the ball 19 times before tonight. Hand off to Fowler. Fowler's knocked down in the backfield. Good play there by Ernest Adams, number 50, the middle linebacker. And that's a loss on the play. It'll be second down and 11.
Adams taking a gap, number 50 right there. See him step up inside. Nobody on him, and makes the play on Fowler, grabs him before he gets started.
That's good. There's a graphic here on the scoreboard that says Jim Kelly has a bruised elbow but will return. That's keeping your fans advised of what's going on. Hooray for the Maulers. You know what a Mauler is? I'll tell you in a moment. McGee is going to the right. Johnson in motion. Dillon loops the ball down for Sanders, and Sanders makes the catch inside the 15. Sanders, with Troy Hill all over him, check that, that's Jesse Johnson, makes the catch. Johnson tried to make him pay there at the end.
Well, Dillon just laying it up over the top. Good protection, good field. If you can see down the middle, he's got good vision. Kind of a post move, more of a banana type of an action there. But Jesse Johnson, the free safety who just joined the club 2 weeks ago, played at New Jersey, was traded from there, spent some time with the Jets. But
you did say Jesse Johnson, didn't you? You didn't say Jesse Jackson, did you? He's running for something else.
Yes, he certainly is. Well, right now, okay. Jesse Johnson's running for his life. He's lucky the ball was a little short.
First down from a 13, Fowler straight ahead. Now I got a chance to see what a Mauler is. A Mauler is a man who used to forge metals in the old mills, and in deference to the industrial roots of Pittsburgh, after a contest that drew 50,000 more entries, they picked a Mauler, M-A-U-L-E-R. Some have said it was named after Ed DeBarlow's Mauls and Maulers, but that's not the case. But it fits, doesn't it? Maulers at the 7-yard line, second down, and six to go for the first down. Dillon doing an outstanding job in relief of Kelly. There's Fowler again. Big man Fowler wrestled down. Don Holly, number 99, is the man that hit him first.
You know, it's been interesting to me, Jim, that when you get in close like this and you don't utilize tight ends in your attack, you got to make the adjustment right there. Nothing fancy. They bring it back up the middle with Fowler, just try to knock him back, but you don't have that advantage of that extra blocker as a tight end or two tight ends.
Johnson, the man in motion. Dillon across the middle, but through behind the man, Richard Johnson. He does that a lot and breaks him for big plays. You go in motion one way and then cut back under the linebackers the other way.
Well, you
that's
know,
Dillon through behind it.
Linebackers start to drop deep. They're in close, so there isn't too much area to drop, but it's Johnson comes across, then he brings it back down the line of scrimmage. Jesse Johnson coming up to make the play, but it's almost like a tight end releasing shallow across that line of scrimmage.
22-yard field goal, hoping to cap off the best drive of the night for either team. Tony Fritsch is in. Mosier to hold. Kicks in, it is good. And it's nothing but Gamblers on the scoreboard. 12:03 to go, second quarter, 13-0 Houston.
We rejoin the game early in the second quarter with Houston leading Pittsburgh 13-0. The Gamblers have the ball on their own 38-yard line, first down and 10.
Sanders is in motion, and Kelly's back to throw, testing it right away on a long throw, and there's his man already, and Jerry Holmes is all over Sanders. Now, Holmes has been saying, no one is challenging me. He's the man who came from the Jets. Sanders took it right to him and completed a long pass on Holmes.
Kelly rolling out to the right. Good blocking on that right side. You see, he has a great opportunity to come back. Just a post pattern out there to Sanders. And if Holmes thinks he hasn't been challenged right here, you can see that he was beat badly.
What impresses me, Don, is Kelly with that elbow coming and throwing long on the first play.
Well, coming back, looking to the right side as he did, the left of the screen, and then coming all the way cross field with it, kind of lulled Holmes, but he made a mistake over there, and he paid for it.
He hands off to Fowler. Fowler, with good strength, gets inside the 15-yard line. Houston looking to put this ball game away in a hurry with 8:15 to go. And Pittsburgh, Rozier hurt. Last time I said it was his ankle, Don, but as I looked again at the replay of Crosby getting that leg around, looked like he hit him in the knee or slightly above the knee instead of in the ankle.
Yeah, it looked like he caught him a little bit higher. You know, a lot of players used to take the tape cans as Rozier sitting on the sidelines. You can see where the ice pack is. And that bare leg right there is where they would take the cardboard tape cans, cut them out to fit the shins, so that when people tried to leg whip them, it was sort of like a catcher's protector's leggings to give them a little bit of help in there.
But they still make those out of cardboard, those cans.
That's exactly right.
That's what they don't do.
But Rozier hasn't learned that one yet, I guess.
By the way,
he will.
Rozier may not come back, we now understand. Rozier may not come out as we see David Graham, who's had a couple of good plays today, kind of wobble off the field for the moment. But the situation is it is second down and 7. The ball at the 13-yard line. Kelly, but he's got a man, and guess who? Johnson, second touchdown of the night. And that makes it his 10th of the year. Looks easy, doesn't it? You keep asking all these people, Don, how do you defense them? They say, we'll double them, or we'll go man-to-man, we'll play zone, whatever. And they continue to put points on the board no matter whom they're playing.
Well, I'll tell you, I watched Johnson. I was talking to him before the ball game down on the field. Just a little guy, short, but is he quick? You see Kelly coming to the right, but Johnson had gone down, put a little quick move to the inside, and it just kind of undressed Mickey Sutton. Mickey Sutton, who had a great game a week ago against Los Angeles, but tonight, and he's a cornerback trying to cover him. That's been converted to strong safety because of injury.
Here's Tony Friction to add the extra point. He does, and it is 20-0. Now, this is a ball club, Pittsburgh, that has been beaten 9 times, but never really manhandled. As of this moment, they are being manhandled. Down by 20 points with 7.5 minutes to go in the half.
Pittsburgh got on the board late in the second quarter with a 14-yard touchdown pass from Glenn Carano to Mark Rao, cutting the Gambler lead to 13. However, on the first play from scrimmage on the Gambler's next possession, Jim Kelly hit Ricky Sanders for a 68-yard touchdown to once again increase Houston's lead to 20. So with the score 27-7, we rejoin the action late in the first half, and the Houston Gamblers once again have the ball.
Back. And they just don't play conservatively, so watch out what they do from the 7-yard line. They cannot throw it. And he's in his own end zone and throws it out to Fowler. A little screen pass, and Fowler gets 2 or 3 yards out to about the 10-yard line. Troy Thomas, number 90, tripped him up. A little help from the linebacker, Craig Wall, 52.
Well, we've seen him utilize that in a couple of games, that little short semi-screen. It isn't a full setup. and throw it out to the side. It's kind of a roll move, and then dump it off to Fowler as he, in most cases, is helping block on the defensive end or the linebacker to that side. Slips by him, and then Kelly dumps it to him with a quick screen move by the lineman.
Kelly, no hurry to get the playoff. 6 seconds remaining to get it off. Won't use all the time off the clock again in case he has to give the ball up. Gets back to Fowler. That's almost like an option play. And now in the last 2 minutes, since it's the first down, they will stop the clock. Stop the clock with a minute to go. McAdoo made the stop with Fowler.
Fowler taking a pretty good hit as he turned upfield with that football. And Jack Pardee said that last week against Michigan, that Fowler was blocking on John Corker most of the football game. He said he took a tremendous beating and was bruised up, but played very well.
Rozier with that knee, remember, ice pack on it.
Also bruised.
First down. Sanders in motion. Kelly. They just throw all the time, and across there making the catch. Coming out of the backfield or off the line of scrimmage, I should say, is Scott McGee. Now remember, they've got McNeil. He has played tonight. Moser, he has played tonight. McGee, he has played tonight. Verdan, he has played tonight. Johnson, he has played tonight. All on offense. Corville has played one play on offense, and he's returned some kicks. So they got a bundle of them, and they all can run. And you'll see these 175-pound halfbacks just absolutely exhausted, the defensive halfbacks, because they got to do a lot of running, not backpedaling. Turn around, just flat-out sprint. First down, 37 seconds to go. Kelly looking to go deep, does go deep down the middle. And the ball is almost picked off by Harper and tended down there for Moser. That stops the clock with 30 seconds to go.
Well, Mark Harper was in excellent position. Post pattern by Moser. The ball a tad short, but he played it perfectly. Should have been caught off, and wonder why they wear gloves. It isn't that cold out here, and you think to yourself, well, maybe if he didn't have those gloves on, he would have hung on to it. But he did manage to play that one extremely well.
Rozier walking off, Kelly now 7 of 15 for 199 yards and 3 touchdowns, 2 to Richard Johnson and 1 to Ricky Sanders. Second down. And he's in motion, Kelly. Looking, oh, Sanders all by himself in the middle there, all by himself. And getting up with the ball is Jerry Holmes, who's been burned again, but I'm afraid, Jerry, they completed another pass on you, even though it was double coverage.
Sanders, once again, he caught that same pattern earlier coming down the slot. Holmes drifting to the outside or the right side. That's Sanders. Holmes will come from the right side of your screen. There he is there as they lay it in the crack. But Kelly does it so well when you think that they're backed up. Nice throw right on the money as Holmes comes in to give him a shot. Picks up a little bit of help from Jesse Johnson. But, Jim, you look back that there they were deep in their own territory, inside of the 10-yard line.
On the 7.
You know, and you might want to say, well, they'll probably just run out the clock now, but they can't because they don't really utilize that running game. They just keep putting it in the air and eating up big chunks of yardage.
Not this ball club. I wonder if the people at Houston, and they've been getting some fair crowds lately, really know what an offense they have and what a quarterback and receivers they have and how they're being talked about all over this league.
Oh, it's fun to watch them. I just enjoy that. You know, maybe it goes back to my days from a quarterback standpoint. It's almost like they're playing a touch football game on the old vacant lot somewhere or an empty field, because they got folks running everywhere and they got such excellent receivers and Kelly, who can execute it so very, very well.
Don and I were standing behind the defensive backs yesterday in practice when all those receivers come flooding out. You can see the problems they have. On motion for Dan. And he's kind of always got all the time in the world. And in the end zone to Johnson. He can't hold on to it. Would have been his third touchdown catch. Now they drilled the ball a little too high for Johnson, who was only 5'9".
Kelly was very, very unhappy with himself. You'll watch that great follow-through, but tremendous velocity as he was going to lay it in the crack. The ball going high to Johnson, who isn't very big anyway, but Kelly had an easy 6 points right there.
Gamblers lead by 20, looking for more in the last 15 seconds of this first half. Second down from 21. Kelly gets the ball. Oh, see you later. No got blockers, but he doesn't need them. Doesn't need them. Fowler. He had two blockers in front of him, but doesn't make any difference. There was nobody to block.
Well, that's that little short screen move by Fowler. You'll see Fowler at the top of your screen going to the left, number 46. And then Kelly just dumping it off as Sam Clancy, 77, jumps in his face. Billy Kidd escorting him, looking around, number 61, the right guard, and Tommy Robinson, the right tackle. So here's Kelly again with Clancy in his face. He said, oh, sorry, Mr. Clancy, but I just hit Fowler, and he's got an easy 6 points.
His first touchdown catch of his pro career. Tony Fritz is in, and if you didn't believe in Houston run and shoot before, believe in him now, because when Fritz puts it through, should he put it through, it'll be 34-7. And he puts it through, and it is 34-7. And let us see. The most points scored against Pittsburgh all year long by Birmingham, 30 points.
We get back to the game early in the third quarter with Houston still leading 34-7 over Pittsburgh. The Gamblers have the ball on their own 27, first down and 10.
Now, Jim Kelly was out for a 75-yard drive engineered by Todd Dillon when Kelly had a bruised elbow, yet he is 9 for 18, officially 264 yards, 4 touchdowns, 2 of those to Richard Johnson, 1 to Fowler, his running back, and the other to Ricky Sanders. So it has been all Houston. Their first two scores set up by turnovers. Since then, Houston's done it all on its own. And Kelly, as always, comes out throwing. And he's got another man wide open out here, and that is Sanders again. First down. Mickey Sutton makes the stop at the 49-yard line. If you just joined us, that's what's been going on all night. The run-and-shoot offense of Houston has just been much too much for the embarrassed Pittsburgh Maulers, who have had little offense at all of their own, and they've been beaten many times, and they're not doing much right in any department.
Well, Ellis Rainsberger said they were going to play a lot of man-for-man this evening, and Ricky Sanders did not run a very complicated pattern. Just a little down and in, or almost a square in move, and Sutton just didn't stay with it.
Here is Sanders in motion on first down. Kelly down the sidelines, and that's a good play over there. I tell you, Mark Harper, the rookie out of Alcorn State, did a good job. Scott McGee flying down there could not make it, and Harper was right with him. By the way, before we see the replay, Mike Rozier, for those of you just joining us, suffered a bruised knee on a leg whipped by Cleveland Crosby, the defensive end, and he is going to the hospital for x-rays. Second down and 10.
Well, it's the second time tonight that Mark Harper, as you see there, number 26, was in perfect position on Scott McGee. And that's the way the defensive back has to play those receivers. They have not done it well tonight.
Rosance looking for a second opportunity. Second down 10. Quick little throw out here to Fowler on the screen. He's got the first down. He's a big, tough man, and he gets inside the 30-yard line. That play picked up 22 yards with Robinson and Khalil leading the blocking and Walls making the stop.
Well, out of the screen, they've gone to double coverage, which meant Fowler underneath on that little quick screen that he had scored on earlier, 51 coming in. He misses the tackle, tries to make a move in there. That's Howard McAdoo. And then nice running by Fowler, hard running on his part.
McGee goes wide to the right, McNeil to the left. And here's Fowler again, and Fowler breaks one tackle, the tackle of Troy Thomas. That gets down near the 25-yard line. Second down and 6.
Draw by Fowler as he'll step left, then hesitate. That's the same thing that he does when he blocks. They pick up a block on the outside. Brian Dawson, the left tackle, kicked out on Doug Holly, and then with good hard running again by Fowler to pick up almost 5 yards.
Houston wins this game. They would be 7-5 with Michigan, the leader, by a game at the moment, or half a game should they win here, to play at New Orleans tomorrow afternoon. Central Division. Second down and about 6. Kelly back. Kelly in trouble. Kelly down. And the fans are thrilled with that because one of the few times that Kelly's been sacked tonight. He was sacked the first two times he had the football tonight. It looked like it might be something different for Jim Kelly. But then the Gamblers righted themselves and Here they are leading 34-7, 9:40 to go in the third quarter.
Sam Clancy, 77. That's 97 coming on the inside. David Graham, Clancy, 77 there. Kelly unhappy at his lineman right there. Tom Robinson, the offensive right tackle, was working on Clancy. He lost him. Clancy going upfield on him.
I beg your pardon. Wasn't Clancy working on Robinson, as it turned out?
Yes, it was. Clancy working on Robinson.
Robinson was trying to work on Clancy. Third down and 12. There's Kelly, dumps it out across the way, and Sanders looking for somewhere to go. And for the first time, we see Sam Sopp in the backfield, number 40, played with the New Jersey Generals out of Kent State, and that's the first play he's been on tonight. That's Mousie Davis, the Mouseketeer man at Portland State. He sent 14 men to the pros. You've heard it so many times, including Neil Lomax, his quarterback for the St. Louis Cardinals. Fourth down. And they're furious over there that they're going to have to try for a field goal. Gamblers don't like to settle for this. They're up 34-7, looking up to go up by 30 points. A 42-yard field goal effort by Tony Fritz, who has not tried one outside the 40-yard mark thus far. This will be his first try of better than 40 yards. 42-yard draw. Let's see if he's got the leg. Still. But oh, that looks like it's got plenty of leg. And from 42 yards up, Tony's liable to go back to the huddle and say, let me try that again. I got the leg. 9:03 to go. It is 37-7 Houston.
Pittsburgh scored its second touchdown in the third quarter on a 12-yard run by William Miller. However, Tony Lee missed the extra point to make the score 37-13 in favor of Houston. We pick up the action late in the third quarter. Pittsburgh has regained possession on the Houston 41 and is looking to make a comeback here on ESPN Classic.
Ball at the 41. And here's Roseanne's being chased by Lloyd Lewis. It's the ball by himself. And stepping out of bounds is Mark Rowell. He's got a first down at the 25-yard line. If you can keep your composure and have some kind of game plan, the Houston defense will give. And here in the third quarter, it has begun to give.
Once again, the bootleg action, 68. Coming in is Lloyd Lewis, the recently signed player. But a good dance step out there after the grab, slightly behind. But a good move to stay in bounds as long as Flowers could.
37-13. Maulers trying to get even closer with better than a quarter left to play. Rosance, quick deep drop, sends it out here to Holman. Holman's got a block in front of him, and then a lot of folks in white shirts. And coming back very quickly was Tony Fitzpatrick, number 62, to put him down. That's a gain from the 25 down to the 18-yard line. Second and three.
Joe Lucan, 64, the right guard, dead center in your picture, blocking right there initially on Fitzpatrick. Then he'll slide out to get in front of it as 32 is Walter Holman drifting out there. You might catch the right corner of your picture. You'll see right there, number 35, Mike Mitchell being kicked all the way out of bounds by Joe Lucas to get that screen started.
Second and three from the 18. Trying to slip through as Miller. He does slip through. Gets inside the 10, first down. And William Miller has shown us something tonight, and that should put him about at the 90-yard mark for the night. Tommy Myers makes the tackle.
Good blocking. Watch the offensive lineman trap across there. They're going with the draw trap. Blocked back by Corral, the center, 55. Don Corbin, the left guard, 69, was coming across. And then excellent running. Lukens right here. 69 coming across was Corbin, as I said, making that trap move, but getting him in deep.
Miller has 88 yards. Down from the six, they give it to Miller again, and he's just not going to go anywhere as Hosea Taylor wraps him down. And it'll be second down and long. And has the flag been thrown?
I believe one was thrown from the far side. One of the linesmen.
And there, Miller is clapping his hands, so it must be against Houston. And it is. You know, signal is delay of the game. Let's see what happened there. And that could be for making contact.
You know, the Maulers have had good success essentially going wide. not had a great deal of success inside other than that last draw trap. But now they're inwards. A little tougher yardage. I would expect that they'd want to try and get outside of the tackles in some combination of blocking. Possibly put it in the air. That bootleg has worked for them.
12 men on the field.
That's
the defense. First down.
12 men on the field. Bill Parkinson almost walked it off down to the one, but then half the distance to the goal line, so put it inside the three. First down. Miller, and that's going to get the touchdown. And it's a second down. They're winding down, as you saw the clock, to the end of the third quarter. 37-13 Houston. But this third quarter, aside from the quick strike and move by Jim Kelly and company downfield in the opening part of this quarter, has it all Pittsburgh.
Well, this is what Ellis Rainsberger wanted to do coming into this football game, was control that ball, keep it away from Houston. Didn't have much success through that first half. The third quarter has been pretty much all theirs.
Miller will dive, and Miller's got it. His second touchdown of the night. That's two more than he had before this game began. And let's face it, if they can continue to play against the Houston offense that they have, the Maulers could be back in the ballgame.
Off the left side, goes high in the air, all bright in front of them. Everybody's submarining defensively, not a great deal of surge. They just kind of gave up their bodies. Then he goes up over the top for 6 points. There's Big Ira as he'll go to the ground right there, gets underneath it, kind of moves the pile back. 85 in front of it is Al Kimchick, the tight end, one of the two tight ends.
Tony Lee, who missed for only the second time this year, will try now to add the extra point. Wide of the hole, and this time he's got it. What is 37-20, a 17-yard or rather 17-point bulge, and they're going to have rolling into the kicker. That will be assessed after they go back to line up. So Tony Lee, who just added the extra point, will be kicking off well in advance of his 35-yard marker, but Bill Parkinson's going to tell us first. He's going to come back and call back the captain to tell him what it was, Burrell. You know that they want the extra point.
Absolutely, that point's already on the board.
Don't take it off the board.
Well, trailing by 17 points, if they could tighten that defense up, and they've had their problems.
Number 55 for the defense, running into the kicker. The point will be set on the kickoff.
That's what we thought. 8 seconds to go in the third quarter. It's 37-20, Houston. 8 seconds left. Ira Albright still hasn't carried the ball, but he sure has done some blocking, enabling William Miller to gain 91 yards and score two touchdowns. Now this ball is taken by Sanders in the end zone. He was hoping it would hop out of bounds at about the one, so they would get some of that yardage back, but it'll come out to the 20-yard line. And that is the end of the third quarter, so we're going to go away again, and we will. It is Houston's ball, first and 10 at their own 20, when we come back to start the fourth quarter. With Don Heinrich in Pittsburgh, I'm Jim Simpson. 15 minutes of playing time to go. What a turnaround in this ball game. Houston has scored but 3 points in the second half, whereas the Pittsburgh Maulers have scored a couple touchdowns. Sanders in motion. Houston with the ball, first down from their 20. Kelly is sacked as soon as he gets the ball. Don Holly, the number two draft choice out of SMU, was on Kelly right away. Check that. That was Fowler. Kelly got the ball to Fowler, and Fowler was put down.
Good job by Holly to come from the left side of the screen right there as a quick move gets him right by Scott Boucher, the offensive left guard. Brian Dawson, the left tackle, number 72, was moving out.
Do you think I was suckered on a play? Not much, huh? I had the man getting sacked.
I would say that's what you call an influence block. It didn't work.
It took me right with it. There's Fowler carrying the ball, and Fowler's got the first down. And a flag is down way over on the sideline. There was a confrontation between Moser and Troy Hill. And way over on the sideline, away from the ball, a flag was thrown.
Well, you know, I think this might be some type of record too, Jim, where we've seen Houston run two running plays consecutively. That's not generally in their repertoire.
Now, this may be on Troy Hill, the rookie out of University of Pittsburgh, where he's a tri-captain. His number's 25. Wait for Bill Parkinson to make the call.
Personal foul, number 25 on the defense.
That's what it is.
Unnecessary roughness. A blow to the head.
Great closure.
First down.
Nearly 25,000 here tonight. Better than 6,000 who bought tickets did not show up. Ball is on the 41-yard line. Houston, fourth quarter, leading 37-20. There's Johnson, throws behind him. And again, as we started the play in our picture, you could see Johnson coming this way, and again he peeled back and ran the other way. That time, Don, he ran a little bit deeper pattern, not under the linebackers, but still Kelly threw behind him.
Yes, he did. He was open again, as Kelly expressing his dissatisfaction with it. And actually, with Johnson starting on that left side, as you're describing him coming across the backfield with two receivers over there, it ends up with three receivers to that side, referred to as a trip set, and then Johnson peeling off, coming back in the direction of Kelly. Kelly missed him.
Now here comes this way again. Kelly being chased, goes, and there's a good play there, but he doesn't catch the ball. Sanders did everything but catch the ball. He came back to it and everything else. Mike McKibben hit him, and Sanders, who earlier had the ball stripped from him to set up a touchdown drive, dropped the ball.
Almost looked like Sanders returning to run. He's so wide open. He slaps his hands together there. Taking a look. That's exactly the same motion that Kelly got hurt on, although he got hit. He recognizes that the linebacker, 53 McKibben, is coming at him, but he's turning to run just a little bit too quick before he puts the football away. Cardinal sin for a receiver.
Ellis Rainsberger, they didn't promise him a Rose Garden. Ellis knew that. He's been around football a long time. Head coach of Kansas State. Conceded Joe Pendry. This is the second game he's been the head coach. And things are tough. Kelly lofting it down one-on-one, and the ball was not caught and tended down there for Gerald McNeil. And that time, Jerry Holmes, who's been beaten a couple of times tonight, was right with him.
Best job that Holmes has done tonight. He crowded that inside on McNeil. He had perfect position all the way. You see the inside position right there? The ball thrown a little bit to the inside. Should have been laid up over the top to give McNeil a full opportunity to go for it, but well played by Holmes.
Dale Walters, who earlier tonight had one blocked, will punt the ball away. And Mark Harper is deep. Catch called for by Harper inside the 10. Now, that's not one of your smarter moves either. Inside the 10, you usually let it go. But Harper, they're caught it at the 5, and the Maulers are in the hole, treading 37-20. 13:40 to go on the clock. Good crowd here. But thus far, the third quarter has been all they've had to shout about. Unless they have any Houston fans. Mike is there, hurt. Brown benched. And this is Holman picking up 4 yards up to the 9-yard line for Diallo. How often do we say that?
That's a happy group. I'll tell you, you talk about the crowd getting excited, Jim. They're excited on the far side of the field as the Three Stooges are making an appearance. But a little fight going on over in the stands has got all the people on their feet. Back in Pittsburgh.
First down, encroachment called, and so that moves the ball out to the 10-yard line. Tony Fitzpatrick, guilty. First and 5.
Well, they've scored 20 points, and they've done an excellent job here in the second half defensively, as they've only allowed 3 points for Houston.
That's right, and they came away with 13 in the third quarter, and have a chance to move this ball a long way here. They're depending mostly, well, look out in the end zone. Look out in the end zone. Was kick out of the end zone. Being pursued and picked up 2 or 3 yards. Came twice close to being sacked. But Tom Rosanth gets out and is run out of bounds by JoJo Heath.
Really a great job by Rosanth, because Pete Caton, number 77, initially will cut him off as he's running that bootleg. You'll see Caton right there. Good move by Rosanth to get away as he slips inside of him. And then coming across to take another shot at him is Ron Relliford, the linebacker, 78 right there. That's big Cleveland Crosby, and he's thinking of somebody picking him off with a blindside. You can see his head on a swivel saying, I don't want to get nailed here.
Second down, 3 to go. Miller. Miller is not going to get the first down. Good tackle there by Tommy Myers, who's made a few good tackles in his long career in the NFL.
Were it not for that nice tackle, it would have been a first down and then some. He had a nice little bit of daylight.
Look at this. 353 for Houston in the first half, 81 for Pittsburgh. In the second half, Pittsburgh has taken the edge away from them, not by a lopsided margin. Taken it away from them and added 13 points to Houston's 3, but it's still 37-20. Third down and short. Look at Albright, he's in motion. And here's Miller following him, and Miller is close to the first down. And it depends as a man, Cleveland Crosby steps in and puts the ball back a half a yard, and so then Donnie Hickman goes up and puts it forward a yard.
Well, you know what they're doing with Miller, with Albright on that, where he almost looked like he didn't know what to do as he was sort of trotting out there. His motion needs a little work when he goes in motion, but they're trying to get him to lead out in front, get an opportunity to make a block, which he did on Mike Mitchell, the corner, for Miller to turn up inside. Came up a little short.
All right, Swatter to kick the ball away. Pittsburgh calls timeout. You know they want to argue them into it. They're inches away, but if they do not make a fourth down, then Houston is about on the 15-yard line and could really put this game out of sight. Well, that is quite a gamble to take when you've got almost 12 minutes left to play and you have finally...
Donnie Hickman, the right tackle, I think.
Well, I
came off limping, a little bit wounded.
It could be cramps or something, because we saw Hickman pick up the ball and move it forward a yard, and he seemed to be in good shape then. Then he walked to the sidelines and went down. And now we see that the argument has been made, and Rosanth and company are going to go for it, figuring, what the heck? Do or die, we're going to try to make it on fourth down and short yardage. They've only got inches to go. If they make it, they still have 85 yards to go or a score. If they don't, Houston's only got 15 to go up by an even larger score.
Well,
when you've been manhandled as they have, you got to take some chances, and Ellis Rainsberger is taking a big chance.
He really is. And you see, some coaches will take it when they're out around their 40 or so, feeling they're going to pick it up, obviously, or they wouldn't go for it. But I don't know that I recall, other than maybe at the end of a football game, anybody going for it this deep in their own territory.
With 11:45 to go. Rosanth takes it, and I don't know. That last surge may have done it. Miller thinks it did. And let's see. They've got it. Rosanth was absolutely stopped, took a step to his left, and dove for it.
Two super individual effort. As he goes right, they want to go off that right side. It's stopped. He doesn't go down, and then jumps over the top, reaches his arm out, almost gets the ball snaked away from him by number 34, Calvin Eason, the safety, as he is trying to extend that arm and that football. He could have had it slapped away, but it worked in his favor.
Now the Maulers want to keep it up. Rosanth still with the ball, pumped once, and now has his man Anderson. Anderson's got the ball, first down, 43-yard line. What a comeback. Rosanth, first of all, doesn't have the first down, then makes the first down, and then hauls off and whips a pass from the 15-yard line all the way down to the 42-yard line of Houston.
And a good move by Greg Anderson. They had that play-action fake behind it out of the eye that they've run so much. Rosanth, a great fake pumped the first time, recocked, Anderson going downfield, went into a little bit of a coast, lulled the corner, Will Lewis, then broke by him, made the big play.
43-yard big play. There's Miller going the other way. Blockers in front of him. Oh, Jose Taylor made a super play right at the line of scrimmage. And it is second down and 10. Now remember, Mike Rozier is out and hurt. Amos Lawrence didn't even suit up. They're going with just three running backs at the moment, one of whom has never carried the ball in professional football in his life, Ira Albright. He's been doing some good blocking. And Glenn Carano started, played the first half, and was benched. After a so-so first half, at the half, the score was 34-7, Houston. He's going to run out of time, but he got it off just as he clicked down to zero, and there's a good play across the way, intended for Flowers. Mike Hawkins got up. And I want to tell you something. I think Rosette might have gotten away with a second or two there. The clock had clicked down to zero and no flag thrown. Third down and nine to go.
Looked like he did. He saw the people up there indicating they were going to blitz. Took some time getting to the automatic. They came out of the blitz. Mike Hawkins, a strong side linebacker, fell back into that zone area and was in pretty good position. Had Rosette not put the ball up high, good chance it would have been picked off by Hawkins.
Third down, nine to go. Deep drop by Rozance and throws it out to whom? I can't tell. Sanders was on one side, Anderson on one side, and Miller on the other side. And Rozance didn't come close to either one of them. And it may be that the patterns were just not run as plotted.
Rozance getting a little pressure as he's going back to set up. It's Caton that comes in there to give him a shot. He knew he had thrown it bad. Anderson had run a hook or a turn and moved to the inside. Miller had run like a flat move away from the line of scrimmage and then upfield. Rozance put it in between both of them. No one around it.
9:54 left as Swatters come in to kick the ball away. JoJo Heath is the man standing at the 10. Low snap, but no pressure. And a bad kick. A second bad kick for Swatters. He has kicked a couple of them that have only gone 10 or 15 yards. That went from the line of scrimmage about 12 yards. Back in a moment, Houston leading 37-20, fourth quarter. Maulers gambled on their own 15-yard line, fourth down and inches. Ellis Rainsberger, in his second game as head coach, made the decision to go for it. They did go for it, but then when they had fourth and nine at midfield, they gave the ball to Swatter to kick it away, and he didn't do too good of a job of it. It's Fowler carrying the football now, and Fowler's going to get a first down. This man runs hard. Remember, Sam Harrell is out with 15 touchdowns, 13 rushing, 2 catching the ball, but he's going to be out for another couple of weeks. He's walking around now on Harrell, who jumped out to a big and early lead in scoring in the USFL. He is ready to play in a few weeks. But Fowler's been doing a commendable job and has caught a touchdown pass tonight, as a matter of fact. Sanders is the man with the big figures, over 200 yards, and Richard Johnson is the man with the most touchdowns, too, for Houston, whereas Miller, running the ball, has 2 for Pittsburgh. First down from the 38-yard line. Kelly hands the ball off to Fowler. Misdirection play. Fowler just, Harper is just left stunned. The tackle is made by Sam Sopp. But there's a case of a man running right over another man. Fowler simply ran right over Harper. Watch this.
That's why Jack Pardee likes it so much. Again, the sprint draw move. Fowler going to the right. Everybody overrunning it. Big hole up front. Blocking by Boucher, the guard. Dawson, and then coming up to make the play is Harper, and Coach Pardee says that's what does it. Right there, Robinson handling Clancy, Robinson number 70, drifting downfield, but good job that time with a whole offensive line, an excellent run.
From the 42, first down, Kelly looking deep, he's looking for Sanders, Sanders can't quite catch up to it. Ricky actually slowed up at about the 15-yard line, half a step, and by the time he got it going again, the ball had outdistanced him. And it's second down and 10.
And he had Mickey Sutton beat. Mickey Sutton having started as a cornerback, a starter at cornerback. Not a big, strong safety as such. He's the kind of guy you want in this kind of a football game, but he was beaten there, 5'9", 170. You look at that quickness, but Sutton just flew by, or Sanders did, I should say.
8:06 to go in the game, 37-20, Houston, and they've got the ball second down 10 in Pittsburgh territory. L.A. flips it back out to Fowler. Fowler's going to pick up another first down. Dragging with him, Howard McAdoo, a middle linebacker, actually took McAdoo for a ride.
Well, you kind of wonder, Kelly's coming down the line to right side, pitches out the old college option to Fowler, and the fact that Kelly has a sore arm, really, Kelly keying the defensive end, which was number 99, Doug Holly, before 51, McAdoo, the middle linebacker comes across to make the play, but I don't think I'd expose my quarterback to running that option.
Fowler over 100 yards rushing, received all enough time for a touchdown of 66 yards. Big night for Fowler, and look at this, Johnson wide open, touchdown, third of the night.
Oh, now I'll tell you.
Sam Sopp comes up saying, look, I want to tell you, Clint Ferdinand interfered with me, but the ball was thrown to Johnson, and that's 32 yards, folks, and that's his third touchdown of the night, and that is his 11th of the year.
On the right side of the screen, if we pick it up here, the ball being thrown, Verdan will catch it. You'll see coming in from the right, 89, Verdan. Well, the ball is caught, so he has it put away. Awfully close over there as Sopp gets picked off. It's almost a screen, but really, it looks to me, well, from that angle, it almost looks like he hit him early. So camera angles can dictate. It's still 6 points.
And Fritz, to add the extra point, now remember, Kelly has caught the USFL record with five touchdown passes, one to Fowler, one to Sanders, and three to Richard Johnson. So he's got 81 receptions. That ties a season record. And, of course, don't forget Kelly with five touchdown passes and with 7:17 to go. Who knows? Kelly might set the record here tonight. Seven 17 to go, 44-20 to score. The Central Division, Houston at the moment is 6-5, and they're going to go 7-5. Michigan plays at New Orleans tomorrow afternoon, remember. Oklahoma's also 6-5, but Oklahoma's got to go down and play on Monday night. We'll have it on ESPN. Tampa Bay, which has won 5 in a row, and now 8-3, one game behind Birmingham. Now, Sam Clancy just got hurt on the extra point, was down for a long time and has now limped off. Remember, Rozier is already out at least for the night. Miller's the deep man as Fritz kicks off and will try to, well, let's see, picked up by the up man. And that is Mickey Sutton, who had quite a return last time. It looked as though he was stopped and he broke away for a long return. This time he gets it out to the 30-yard line.
You know, Tony Frisch has given them fits here this evening with changing up his kicking, most of the time kicking from one side to the other, squib style, but then occasionally going deep with it. It really kept that kick return team off balance.
Tom Rosance, who had an excellent opportunity to keep the drive going, but he threw it between two men on third down. They had to kick the ball away, and remember the time, that clock is all in favor of Houston. They're up by 24 points. Trying to break those two lost records, both in overtime. Downfield for Flowers, and Flowers has the ball, and Flowers will score. Now that's not the longest touchdown by Flowers. He had a 98-yarder while playing for Arizona against Washington last year, and this one, folks, is only 70 yards. Only 70 yards.
Well, Tom Rosance aired that out. Absolutely beautiful. Laid it up over the top. You'll see him drop back and throw. Good protection. Watch him follow through and really hum it. Now, Flowers in a streak down the right sideline. Right smack on the money as he goes by Mike Mitchell, number 35, the defensive corner. Rosanz again from a different angle as he just cranks it up and then watches, and he said, come on, be there. It is. Take it home, Jackie Flowers. And he did.
78 is Cleveland Crosby, assessed with a personal foul. It will be assessed after the kickoff. That's the second time tonight that has happened. The other time was against Hosea Taylor.
Well, we've seen Houston score very quickly, as explosive as they are. First time tonight that the Maulers have really peeled off a big one, and Tom Rosanz may have earned himself a starting job next week.
He certainly might, and that will be no easy deal. New Jersey was bounced by the Washington Federals last night, and that's whom the Maulers get a week from Monday night.
They are going to be tough. You know they're going to be coming out of the ground.
Barbaro, their good defensive back, however, is in for knee surgery. He'll try for a two-point conversion. Never made one this year. Rosanz looking. It'll be tough to get this two-point conversion. It'll be tough to get this one. And he doesn't get it. So they just get six. Come away empty again. And it is 44 to 26 the score, with 6:33 to go. Back in a moment. The Maulers in danger of losing their sixth in a row.
Pittsburgh, 26-6.
The Gamblers looking to leave here 7-5, get Oklahoma on the 20th, Jacksonville, Denver, which has lost four in a row, Chicago showing muscle, San Antonio and Memphis have been showing some muscle recently. It is not a series, with the exception of Denver and Oklahoma, of winning ball clubs, and Houston can certainly put points on the scoreboard. Todd Dillon over there, he'd like to get another shot. He was in the first half when Kelly went out with a bruised right elbow. Let's see if they try an onside kick here. That's what they're all gathering for. And here it is, and Tommy Myers has it. So it belongs to Houston right there at the 39-yard line. Now, here is a word about Mike Rozier, who went out. First of all, he had the sprained ankle. We saw him tape that. Then we saw the leg lash by Crosby that hit him in the knee and went down. We saw the ice. We told you he went in for x-rays. The good news is that Mike Rozier x-rays came out negative. So while Rosanz is looking pretty good at quarterback, Rozier should be able to come back and play, if not next week, certainly the week after. Kelly, 15 of 28, has tied the USFL record with 5 touchdown passes, 365 yards, but they're going to let him rest now, especially with that bruised right elbow, and give the ball back to Todd Dillon, the backup quarterback, with 6:19 and counting to go. Up, and this is Donnie Williams in for Fowler, as Jack Pardee is showing mercy and also making sure that none of his men get hurt here. Ernest Adams makes the tackle of Donnie Williams, and that's the first down across midfield to the 49-yard line.
Well, Jack Pardee mixing it up with,
well, Fowler may not be able to get a rest. Williams is coming out.
Yeah, he got hurt. He's limping out of there. But you look at this smaller team, they'd average just under 20 points a game defensively. Offensively, a little over 15. They've scored almost double that here tonight.
Fowler's had a great night. Better than 100 yards rushing. Caught a touchdown pass. And he has to come back in. They're going to give him the ball again. And down he goes, taking more time off the clock. Now, this is something that's different than early on, Don. When we were down in San Antonio in third or fourth game of the season, they were so locked in their run-and-shoot offense that they hardly ran the ball at all. They got down trying to run time off the clock and almost didn't know how to. They kept throwing the ball, because that's what Mousy Davis likes. But now they've begun to run the ball just a little bit more, keeping the defenses a little bit more honest. And thanks to they're being able to run the ball, they can run time off the clock now when they've got a big lead such as this, 44-26.
Mouse Davis was dancing around a little bit there. He's not used to running.
He'd rather have had this happen. So Dillon's going to try to look all by himself. Across the way there is Clarence Verdan. And Verdan is inside the 10-yard line. It is first and goal to go. Kelly and Dillon are interchangeable. And now they're coming back in what, flag down? But they still mark the ball at the 9. Verdan is coming back.
I don't see any flag as Verdan, with great speed, they goes had down the left sideline. That half roll we've seen so many times, firing cross field, just out-legged him down that right sideline and went by Jerry Holmes. And
there is a flag
there. He spins it, and I believe.
Right there.
And Jerry Holmes, you know, losing a little cool, says, take one in the chest.
You know, I have, Jerry Holmes has proven himself. So no matter what I say, Jerry Holmes is an outstanding cornerback. But isn't it odd that you make all these statements to appear in the paper that no one is testing me and I want to be challenged, and I'm looking ahead to this. I think Jerry Holmes, with one notable exception tonight, has been beaten.
He's been tested well.
Oh, boy. And that entire secondary has
beaten a few times.
This run-and-shoot offense tested. Oh, Dillon fell on the ball after he dropped the ball. So that little push he gave there to Verdan was strictly frustration. Absolutely frustration. Now Dillon set all kinds of records at California State, Long Beach. We normally say Long Beach State, but the official thing is California State, comma, Long Beach. Cal State, comma, Pomona, whatever. There's the clock. 44-26 at the end of the half. The score was 34-7, an amazing display.
Yes, and they're third in pass defense, that Mauler ball club, and they're getting cut up this evening.
We saw two number one pass defenses, Arizona and then New Orleans, go down. Oh, look at this. He overshoots his man, Terrence Verdan, at the goal line.
Verdan was there. Kelly could have lowered the sights just a little bit. Kelly rolling left side, throwing on the move, which he does extremely well, but it's a little high and away as Sam Sopp, who just joined the club on Monday, number 40 at safety, comes across, but he was late. Had the ball been put in there, Kelly would have set a record.
Well, this is Dillon.
Yes.
Third down and long. And now looping over the back and trying for the catch, and it is no good, and Gerald McGee is all upset with himself, and Jerry Holmes was right there. Holmes was playing the man, and the ball was thrown over him, and McGee thought he should have caught it.
Holmes played that extremely well. Holmes, good size for a corner. Right here, all he can do is play the man. When the man's eyes tell him, or his hands go up as they did right there, then he's got to drive into him, which he did. That's an excellent move by a veteran cornerback.
He had great years with the Jets. Now the University of West Virginia has two interceptions. Tony Pritchin to try a field goal of 29 yards. He was hit already on his longest of the year, 42 yards tonight. One of his frequent field goals now. And the score is 47-26. And this is the worst thumping that the Maulers have taken all year long. Their biggest loss has been by a total of 15 points all year. They're at the moment losing by 21 points. Miller, close to 100 yards rushing the ball, as deep as Tony Frisch will kick off. As Don has pointed out, he has kicked them high, has kicked them long, has kicked them along the ground. He squibbed them, and that ball is picked up across the way there by Johnny Durden. Durden down the sidelines, and Durden has stepped out of bounds. Either that or Fred Gill is being awfully nice to him, because Bruce simply laid off him. It looks like Relaford really ran him out of bounds. And with 3:27 to go, here comes Carano back on the field. Now, just when we're talking about Rosance, Carano is back in the ball game as a quarterback.
I'm not sure that last time Carano was throwing, or Rosance was throwing across field on that two-pointer. He took a pretty good lick and kind of came out holding his arm a little bit and sitting down on the bench by himself. Appears to be a little bit wounded.
Well, Carano's back out, first down, and that's the booze. They're unaware that Rosance may be shaken up. Carano going deep. Oh, he's got his man right there, but it's going to be picked off. First interception of the night. That is the veteran Tommy Myers. Back across the 40, across the 50. They're not really trying to tackle him hardly at all. And finally, it is Lucas who pulls him down. But there's a flag down back at the 32-yard line in Houston territory. Myers with the interception, his first in the USFL. He had a number over in the NFL playing with New Orleans.
Tommy Myers had that zeroed in all the way. Watching him come from that free safety spot, the ball just too long in the air by Carano. You'll see it. He launches it high. In the meantime, Myers is drifting across. He'll come in. He knew it all the way. You'll see from the other side, Mike Mitchell, 35, picks up a great block. He didn't catch it. He's probably the one that's going to be called for a clip, but really a nice block for Myers to return that football. Myers says, I can't run this far. How about a little help?
Block above the waist from behind.
Well, with Jim Kelly on the bench, we said five touchdown passes equals the touchdown record. Corrado's not having any kind of season, as is Kelly. Nobody is, because with the five touchdowns tonight, Kelly on the bench now, being given the rest, has 28 touchdowns. That's more than any quarterback has thrown in a single season in the USFL, and he's got six games left to play in the regular season. Here's Todd Dillon handing off to Fowler. Fowler rambles. He is well over 100 yards, has been for some time, and still picks up 8 or 9 yards every time he carries the ball.
Well, you talk about Kelly and the touchdown passes. They're nothing new to him. He threw 44 touchdown passes at East Brady High School right here in the Pittsburgh area.
He might do it with the Houston Gamblers right here in the USFL. 16 more in six games, that's not much. And Rosance is going off the field, and he may be hurt rather badly, because you can tell when you put the towel around the head like that, you just don't want to see anybody or anybody to see you. You are just upset. And another man is down at the field, on the field now. There's Fowler. And let's see who is down for. Well, you can see it's Adams, the middle linebacker.
It's been a tough night for these Maulers in the way of injuries. Taking turns going down. I thought Rosance might have gotten hurt when he was trying to throw across the field. He wanted to get the ball back and waited just a little.
Here's Fowler. He's going to reel off some more yards. Has another first down, ridden down across the way by Mike McKibben.
Nice move by Fowler. He starts to come up the middle with this one. He wanted to go directly up the center. You'll see him hesitate, come up the middle. Nothing there. Veers outside. That's a good move for a big back. 93 is Ike Griffin chasing him. 53 coming across. McKibben, the linebacker. He calls the defense and signals.
2 minute warning. 2 minutes to go. This game belongs to the Gamblers. Has since the half. Now they now lead 47-26. Where do we begin? Five touchdown passes tonight. 28 sets the new record. Ricky Sanders, better than 200 yards catching the ball. Fowler has rushed for 124 yards. Caught three more balls for 66 yards and a touchdown. That's 190 total yards for him. Richard Johnson has caught three touchdown passes. Houston tonight. No question about that. Rodan is the man in motion. And Todd Dillon, the backup quarterback, has time. Now scrambles a little bit. He better get himself out of there. He saw McAdoo coming for him, and so he simply went down. That takes some more time off the clock.
You know, you go back to Jim Kelly on the sideline, smiling, happy, good night, in front of a home crowd. He credits the old veteran quarterback, Earl Morrill, from the college days, for having helped him so much in learning how to read defenses, how to look for receivers. And I don't think you can get a better guy to show you how to do it with down on Howard Schnellenberger's staff.
Second down and 10. They're letting this clock run down as much as they can, and why not? A long night for everybody, for Houston. It's been a nice night. They've enjoyed nearly every bit of it, except the third quarter when the Maulers took it to them and scored a couple of touchdowns. There's Dillon handing off to Fowler, who's already got 190 yards, but doesn't get much more than that from there. As Howard Griffin puts him down. Stacked up tonight, and now this is it. Michigan, which broke its losing streak, has Houston a game behind it, and Oklahoma, which was in a tie before this game, has a big effort ahead Monday night playing Tampa Bay. But Houston is a game behind Michigan. Michigan's got to play at New Orleans tomorrow afternoon. Thus far,
There have been 570 total yards racked up by the Houston offense. You heard me right, Heinrich. 570 total yards racked up.
That's hard to get that many against the wind. There's nobody out there.
And remember that Pittsburgh absolutely dominated the third quarter with several long drives for scores. Mossy Davis's offensive group has come up with 570 yards.
Woo! That's a bunch. You know, the thing that's interesting is you see the comparison there. Changes from the first half to the second half, where Pittsburgh over 200, done better than Houston that direction. But you go to the giveaway takeaway thing, Jim, and coming into this game, how they can be misleading. Houston was a minus 13. They picked up a couple, so they go to just minus 11. On the other hand, the Maulers were plus 2. They lost one, and now they're plus 1. But that's a big spread, and they're getting beat soundly.
Dillon putting the ball out, and he's throwing for Bruce Threadgill, a backup quarterback, who's also a wide receiver. That is fourth down. 56 seconds to go. That stops the clock. And that should be the end of the Houston offense for tonight. Kelly, many things that they're talking about Jim Kelly. East Brady, his hometown, loved Jim Kelly. He has not disappointed the fans coming home tonight. And Jack Pardee, if there's anything to erase two overtime losses, if they could ever be erased, it'd be a 570-yard performance with your offense. Harper gets away from one, and out of bounds he goes at the 27-yard line.
Good move by Harper to lead that first man down the field. And
they ran into the kicker, however, and they will get the ball back. Houston will get the ball back. Just what I said, we've seen the last. They ran into the kicker, and so bring back on the offense.
You know, you talked about Jim Kelly and the great night that he's had here. You go back to those same high school days you mentioned, and Joe Paterno at Penn State had recruited him as a linebacker. Well,
personal foul, running to the kicker, number 31 on the defense. That's a first down.
46 seconds left. And Jim Kelly's a big hero tonight. I guess if anybody's going to come in and blow away the Maulers to their worst defeat, at least it's a local man who has come back home to do it. Throwing those five touchdown passes. Remember, suffered a severe bruise to the inside of his right elbow in the first half, and Dillon had to replace him for several series of plays. But he came on to throw four more touchdown passes. Motion. They'll give the ball to Fowler, and Fowler gets back to the line of scrimmage and maybe another yard or two. And they've only got 40 seconds to go. Pittsburgh will have lost its sixth in a row. They've got to go play New Jersey, and we'll be there a week from Monday night to see both of those teams have righted their act. New Jersey losing to Washington. Pittsburgh to sixth in a row tonight. And Houston, well, Houston feeling pretty good about things. And their next game will be Oklahoma, a week from tomorrow, Sunday the 20th, and that will be played in the Astrodome. Kelly coming out, they're going to let this thing run down. It is all over, and Don Heinrich, final score 47-26. What a display by Houston and Jim Kelly.
It really was an outstanding job by that. Jim, I'll see you, I guess, in a couple of weeks.
That's right. I'm Jim Simpson with Don Heinrich, 47-26, Houston over Pittsburgh. Happy Mother's Day tomorrow to all of you. And good night from Pittsburgh.